Chat is live. Okay, awesomeness. Bring out your geek. I really can't say what episode it is. I want to say technically we're on like 27. We skipped a couple because they weren't very good.
I think we should just start applying totally arbitrary numbers.
532.
This is going to be episode 132 and a half, and then we could have episode 43 later.
That rocks. Yeah, because I think we'll probably have like some outtakes from the missing episodes that weren't so hot, but probably not the actual episodes. So.
Honestly, I think the outtakes are the funniest bit anyway. So.
you may want to repackage it out of the missing episodes that weren't so hot. May not be the ideal packaging for your outtakes.
Perhaps a new marketing strategy.
I want to refine that a little bit.
I'm not real hot on the marketing stuff, so okay.
I'll brainstorm some ideas and email you.
All right. That works for me. Okay, so we have a guy on the show, which is a first for us, and probably a last for us as well.
Boy, you've got real high expectations. I'm going to destroy this. Excellent. Good. That's excellent.
Hey, they broke the mold after you, Kelly.
I guess. First and last time. All right.
But we did want to have
a very special guest.
We're a little silly right now, but we did want to have Kelly on because Kelly and I got to hang out at C2E2.
Yay! And I can't wait to hear all about it.
And, you know, I feel kind of bad. I really had just about every intention. My intentions were purely interesting. I had every intention of doing cosplay, but I just didn't feel well enough. And it was pretty much all I could do to, like, wear a nerdy shirt and get out of the house. So, but well, Kelly, the man, was all chained up.
That's
she
right.
She's a big damn awesome. Hero in a brown coat, so.
I like it.
With a hat made by, Jane's hat made by Mel.
Nice.
That got a tremendously large amount of compliments on there, because there were a lot of they were vending Jane's hats out there, but nothing approached the quality that what Mel has done, so.
Fantastic. I know, I'm kind of hoping I can sneak myself onto her list of people to make Jane hats for.
I bet you can.
I think you could.
Yeah. We have a couple here.
I think I would look cunning in a Jane hat.
I think you look cunning in any hat, darling.
Oh, you're too kind. I'm wearing a space scarf, so, you know.
Is that what that is? It's hard to tell with the...
Yeah, it's a little dark, but no, it's the cosmos.
Rocking.
Yeah, so this was my first Comic-Con ever, and therefore also my first, as much as I do cosplay, I guess, you know. But
that's awesome.
First, so it was a series of firsts on that. So.
Well, that's exciting.
If you guys go to bringoutyourgeek.com, look under events. We do have C2E2 2014. There's a bunch of photographs. And also, Kelly, you have some up on your website as well, right?
Yeah, I've got a blog, and I chronicled the 3 days that I was at C2E2 in medieval fashion.
There is something really exciting and dichotomous about a blog in medieval fashion.
Yes, indeed. So there's photos out there, and on day two got a chance to connect with Jean, and that's when I was Jane, and boy, within a couple minutes I ran into the only other Firefly cosplayer there in the entire session. She had done a really good job with her outfit, so it's very cool.
Well, I am planning to cosplay Kaylee at some point. I typically do costuming with my best friend, and we are, you know, pretty typically go big or go home. So I think our best so far, and you can see on the website, is our Sally and the mayor from Nightmare Before Christmas. But we did some, I was Black Widow and she was Scarlet Witch for this year, this past costume sort of season. And we rocked that one pretty hard, I think. So.
Awesome. You know, and if, Kelly, you do decide to go to the one in August, right. Have you thought about that at all?
I have not. I will not declare an official position because I get in trouble if I take an optimistic view to say, yeah, I think maybe I'll go to that, and then it doesn't work out. So
okay. Well, if
under evaluation.
If you go and you do your Jane's hat again, he had the gloves, he did a good job.
Awesome.
I will do wash again.
Nice. Very nice. I wish I had the vacation to come out and join you, because I'd totally Kaylee it up for that.
And it's a cute, I love her outfit. It's very cute with the umbrella. And
exactly. And I have the coat that she wears, and I can put my hair up in the little buns. And
awesome. Okay, so my favorite, I had two favorite cosplays that I ran across, because I think that's really, I think, one of my favorite things about going to Comic-Con is mm-hmm. everybody dressing up. One of which was the 9-foot-tall Grim Reaper that said I was cute for Redhead.
Amazing.
And he had, like, the voice modulator, so he sounded like Satan.
But a friendly Satan. He was a very cordial, friendly.
Very jovial.
Yeah.
Well, Satan was an angel.
He was kind of awesome. He was cracking jokes, and you know, I think, you know, because he was also scaring children, so I think he kind of had to, you know, kind of like the alien that was there. They had like the what are they called?
The xenomorph.
Yes, there was one of those, and she was hugging all the children.
Amazing.
She was like, "Can I have a hug?" And all the kids were like, "Oh, I don't."
Hello, my baby. Hello, my darling. Yeah.
Ice pirates. Oh my god. Which I watched recently, and that's
very nice.
But he was really funny, and I think that's partially because he was scaring children. But he was really well done, and then also the dragon, and they had like shirts that said "fire breathing dragon" on him. He didn't actually breathe fire, but he was on stilts, and then his wings were like these huge structures that he was using to like walk, almost like a creature out of the Dark Crystal.
Wow.
And they had like the very end of the wings had like these rubber stoppers on them, kind of like crutches. Yeah. And so he would rear up, and you could tell, like, it took a lot for him to do that, because he would shake. Like, his whole body would just shake from, like, the muscle strain that he was under. But he was just larger than life. And I got an awesome shot, complete with J.J. Abrams' lens flare, fighting Tusken Raiders, the Sand People.
Nice!
And that was really awesome.
I admire so much all of the effort that people put into this. Like, I love to put together a costume, and it's so much fun, and to go places where people will recognize you and kind of want to take your picture. It's really fun. Like, I don't consider myself a cosplayer. I'm sort of a dilettante at best.
Me too. Yeah, that's me as well.
But not for lack of trying, mostly for lack of resources.
Most for lack of disposable income.
Exactly. We went to Anime North one time, and that's one of our cons here in Canada, and we dressed up as a couple of characters from Death Note, and we put some thought into this. Like, I dyed and cut my hair according to the character, and she wore lifts in her shoes, and we went as a couple, and like a male, female, Jill always plays the guy. She's so much better at it than I am, so she can pull that off. And we got pictures, and everybody loved us, and we had another character from that, like somebody who had come out to cosplay another character from that series had come over and was like, "Can I get a picture with you guys?" And it was so cool. That was my first experience with that whole kind of concept, and it was just it feels like you're part of the crowd. You have a role there when people are recognizing you and appreciative of the effort you went to and things like that. It's kind of fun. I like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm officially horrible at cosplay because the entire day. So there would be, you know, but there were tons of compliments. So, "Hey, nice hat, nice Jane's hat." And then eventually I was like, "Oh, they're talking to me." And then I go through and then, "Hey, Jane." And it would be a good 4 or 5 beats later then, and I was like, "Oh, yeah, hi, hi."
I don't know. I think that's actually kind of appropriate. Jane would be a little bit clueless about that whole thing, right? So you're very in character.
I was in character. That's why I like that idea.
The rebranding.
Yeah, I can't remember the name of the anime series, but it's the one where there are a bunch of little kids who are countries. Because I just want to kind of mention, we talk about cosplay. My youngest daughter went as Canada to this con down in Texas. She's going here again pretty quick, and she went as Canada, and I believe her friend went as America. And basically, in the anime series there, no one's really sure who Canada is. They always, hey, so who are you again? Are you America? And he's like, no, I'm not America. I'm Canada. Oh, okay. And so,
just like when you travel.
It was cool. So she liked being in Canada quite a bit.
Well, give her a big old high five for me.
I certainly will.
So I didn't get to do any panels. It was a full 7-hour, 5-mile day kind of thing. But yeah. Kelly did get to go to the Breaking Bad panel. Do you want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I got to go to three, and the first one was the Breaking Bad panel. It was RJ Mitty. Who played Walt Jr. In the series, and I know that Jeans has steadfastly refused to watch Breaking Bad. Bronwyn, do you have any familiarity with it?
I do. I'm a chemist by trade, so I struggle a little bit with some of the characters because I really need somebody to root for, and
not a lot of them.
No.
No. except for Saul, you know, you gotta love Saul.
But I certainly am a little bit familiar. You can't be in the business without hearing about Breaking Bad. So.
Yeah. Well, RJ is the chemist's son, and he has cerebral palsy in the storyline. And the actor who plays him, RJ Mitty, also has cerebral palsy. He doesn't require a crutch. RJ doesn't require crutches for mobility now. He did at one point, but he kind of worked his way out of them. But the character, he did it, so he had to kind of try and regress on some of those things there. But he is
difficult.
Yeah, he talked about just being a little bit uncomfortable and saying, you know, I work really hard to be out of this mode and not to go back into it. But he started when he was 14 on the show and finished when he was around 21, 22. So he kind of grew up on the show. He was an incredible...
That has got to be disorienting.
It's an interesting group to grow up around, but I guess... The actors aren't much like their characters in terms of there's some pretty... Bryan Cranston, I guess, is tremendously funny off camera and also very supportive and a kind of a guy who's into the craft. So he had some pretty good role models to be around in terms of acting and those types of things. The characters, not so good role models, but...
Not so much, you know?
But RJ was a remarkably thoughtful young man, and he kind of stepped through a lot of things on the series and told, you know, for all the folks, all the inside Breaking Bad stories and told those things. But a lot of what his energy goes into is around bullying and different types of programs and awareness and things to go on to try and continue to prevent occurrences of that. And a lot of his point, some of the stories he's told, is that you really need to work on people to say, be the person that takes the first step. You know, if you see something that's wrong, step in and intervene and do that.
Do something. Yeah.
And it was really kind of cool to see somebody who's had some success and seems to have a lot of a really kind of bright future, overcoming some issues on there very effectively, really making it a non-issue. He doesn't really kind of talk about it much in terms of that as having to overcome anything, versus he says everybody's got something to work through, so I don't really worry.
And those are the everyday heroes that it's nice to see in the public eye, right? The people who are just, you know, they're getting through the day and they're doing the best they can and they're just trying to make a little bit of a difference, you know, just trying to make their life count for something. That's pretty cool. That's somebody you can look up to.
And he's really cool, kind of self-aware, because as the people started coming up for questions, there were the folks going, hey, can I run up and take a selfie with you real quick? And he just kind of looks left and right and goes, well, if you can get up here and back before that security guy gets you, sure. And they were able to, and this great person started moving. But I think the fact he kind of acknowledged that kept the security guy at bay for at least a moment longer, let the person get their selfie. But just a great guy, and he was fun, really fun to listen to, and it was good to
do that. Yeah, I obviously I didn't get a chance to go to C2E2, which is sad, but I have been to a couple of kind of different con type environments, and one that I went to was super fun. It was a fan expo in Toronto, and we went to a panel with oh my goodness, I'm so bad with the names. What's his dude? Played Spike and Buffy. James Marsters. There, I knew it would come to me. And Juliet Landau, who played Drusilla. And I used to love, you know, Buffy. There's, you know, Firefly is probably my favorite of Joss Whedon's work.
But we all know when Buffy's on at your house by your Twitter feed.
Exactly. I'm sorry, but that movie is amazing, and anyone who tells you otherwise is lying through their teeth. So, but James Marsters he was so funny. After an hour panel, watching them interact and hearing him answer questions, and it was a really well moderated panel, which makes a huge difference. If you have a good moderator, it keeps the pace going, and it really makes a difference. So, but my face ached from laughing after an hour panel with these two. Like, I was dying. I had tears, you know, ugly cry, laughing. It was so funny. And they had quite a wide variety of people in the audience, from the very young to the very old. And it was really neat to see kind of the depth and breadth of the appeal of these actors and of that show, and of, you know, just to still be so kind of relevant that people are that interested, you know. And one of my favorite questions is this little kid, tiny little kid, he put his hand up, and the moderator, you know, was like, okay, honey, you can go. And he got so flustered at first when she chose him that he forgot what he was going to say. So he was like, oh, and he got all shy, and his parents were there, and the moderator was like, oh, it's okay, honey, we'll come back to you, you can ask the last question. So they moved around, and he thought out his question, and his parents asked him, like, write it down or talk, you know. And so true to her word, she actually came back to him for the last question of the panel, and he stood on his chair when he finally figured out that she was, yes, you can speak now, it's your turn. He stood on his chair so he could be heard, and he's like, do you like Angel better when he's bad or when he's good? And it was so cute. Juliet Landau's like, I like Angel however I can get him.
And very cool.
James Marsters was like, oh, I liked him so much better bad. He was so much more fun. But it was just so cute because this poor kid, he was just, everybody was cheering for him, and, you know, all of us around him in the seats, because he was sitting just in front of us, and we were like patting him on the shoulder, like, good for you. It's your job. It's your turn, buddy. You know, come on up, ask your question.
Yeah, I was, so the third day on Sunday was kind of a throwaway day for me. The way the pass worked, if I paid for 2 days, it's the same as paying for 3 days. So I said, yeah, I'll do all three and catch a little bit. But I didn't have a lot of, I was kind of saying, I'll go for a little bit, and if it means I get headed back out earlier, that's just fine. And there were two panels that day. I went to Defiance and Warehouse 13.
I'm so jealous of those two. I wanted to go to those two so bad.
They were amazing.
Now you're just being rude.
Yeah, it was in the, you know, it was weird. You know, fortunately, everyone was just glad there was one person we were worried about showing up. She didn't show up, and it was amazing because she wasn't there. But the on the warehouse, the thing I liked on both of them is to see the genuine rapport between the actors. I mean, I think they must do this a lot. They're used to it.
Of course.
Tony Curran is on, is that how you say his name?
Yep, I think so.
He's on Twitter now.
Oh, he is now?
So I want to see if he live tweets during the show.
Ooh.
That would be very cool because, excuse me, trying to remember who it is. God, I'm drawing a blank now. Julie Benz. Julie Benz is the only American in the main cast. because Grant Bowler's Australian, Tony is clearly Scottish, Jamie Murray English, and Alec. Can't remember the actor's name now. Drawn a blank on it. The actor who plays Alec is a Canadian, so Grant Bowler and Tony, the entire interview were mocking each other's accents.
That's funny.
And they would go back and forth at each other, and it was just hilarious. But the Warehouse 13 It was in the main big conference hall for C2E2. It was the last panel of the show.
I'm impressed you got in.
Well, I was too, but it was you can buy a VIP ticket for C2E2, and what that works for the main room is they take about the first 14 rows, and those are reserved for people with VIP passes, so they all get up closer, and then the rest of us cattle are in the back. Uh-huh. So we all kind of load in, waiting for the Warehouse 13 thing, and I knew I loved Eddie McClintock in the most manly way possible before, but this whole session,
it's truly a bromance now.
It is. It has blossomed into something. He is so freaking cool because the whole front section was empty. There was a few people here and there, but it was basically a wasteland up there. And so they all come out, and A looks out. He goes, "Well, why are all these empty seats here?" And somebody goes, "Well, it's VIP." And he's like, "Well, they didn't show up. Everybody, get up." And he pulled everybody in the crowd forward into the VIP section to begin with. And then they sit down and talk. And I guess Pete's character on Warehouse 13 and Eddie are not entirely different.
That has certainly been my impression.
there's a lot of, the hey, hey, hey is how Eddie used to greet actors. And they said, oh, that's what Pete's going to say now. And they are very similar in terms of maturity level and all that.
He's crazy immature funny on Twitter and got in trouble for it from like his producers and stuff. And I mean, like, he had this hilarious picture that he had, like, it was, I can't remember exactly. I want to say, like, his head photoshopped on, like, porn star in like a banana hammock, and there were unicorns. And they made him take it down. Tone it down as well. So I'm wondering if now that he's not going to be on that show anymore, it's not going to be airing. I'm wondering if he won't kind of go back to his really goofy stuff, which was outrageously funny.
If the panel was any indication, he's well on that road.
Have you seen some of the cross tweets between him and Nathan Fillion lately? Because he's been on.
That was hilarious.
Yeah. I am dying.
And then Shatner saying to Nathan that he was going to teach him how to tweet because he didn't have a hashtag.
I did miss that part.
That was awesome.
When you get schooled by Shatner, that's a special kind of bad. Of course, what won the day for me is they had an Alice Cooper story. Jeans is I don't think Bronwyn, if you know, but I'm a little bit of an Alice Cooper fan. And
pretty much. Obsessed.
It's okay. You should see my house. It's entirely decorated in Tom Waits, so I can relate.
So it'd be like that. Alice is just Tom Waits with a guillotine and stuff like that. But it's just little subtle differences.
A little creative license there, but I'll give it to you.
It's a nuance. So, but
there's nothing
like
a guillotine.
Guillotines are awesome.
I'm sorry, but jeans, that's gonna have to be a tag for this episode.
Like
a guillotine.
Alice Cooper is just Tom Waits with a guillotine.
That's all it is.
Hence the name of the show.
There you go. The character, the actor who plays Arnie and Pete were actually in the Atlanta airport having a little bit of food waiting for their flight. And it was hilarious because, and this is back to the report thing, they actually reacted out the scene, having the dialogue between themselves to mimic it, where it was like, so Eddie McClintock starts it off and he goes, hey, look over there, don't, 3 o'clock, don't stare, just look real quick. It's Alice Cooper, isn't it? Yeah, don't look, don't stare. Oh, he's so cool. Should we go talk to him? No, we can't go talk to him. Oh, I like Alice Cooper. No. All right. So then they keep eating, and then towards the end of their meal, they go, all of a sudden each of us feel a hand on our shoulder, and Alice Cooper's head floats in between our two, and he goes, are you the guys from Warehouse 13? I love your show.
Nailed it.
And,
Yes.
And they were just going over there, and so then Eddie's like, and then I'm like, I can get you on the show. Do you want to be on the show? Do you want to be on the show? And of course, Alice's like, yeah, I love the show. And I saw some of the Twitter traffic after this hookup in Atlanta, and it was they were, Eddie was going to do everything he could to get him on the show. Sadly, it didn't work out, but he actually wrote the scene. Which was going to basically be when they're walking through the warehouse one time, Artie would just be walking by and they'd pass one booth and there would just be Alice sitting in a chair reading a newspaper.
Okay, and of course he'd be an artifact.
Stop and go, is that Alice Cooper? Yeah, don't ask. Which would have been perfect. That would have been a great little scene. But sadly.
Totally.
But Eddie is a nut because the moment he sat down, he started pulling on his microphone cord, and all the other actors are like, "What are you doing? What are you doing?" And he's like, and then he had to get up and move something, so he hiked his pants down to kind of do the plumber crack thing as he was trying to work on some things, and he gets it all out. And he basically, what he did is he pulled enough cord of his microphone off so that he could step off the stage, walk to the middle of the auditorium, and be the one asking people questions.
That's awesome.
He's just great. Really fun. And it was hilarious. I mean, talked about your face hurting.
Right?
I just laughed through that entire session. It was so, so funny.
Follow him on Facebook. He's good on there.
Okay.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. It's always fun when they get to be interactive like that, right? Because it kind of allows you to feel like there's not quite it's not quite the fourth wall situation going on, right?
Yeah, and he's talk about a bent down to earth kind of guy. It was clearly there was no wall on any of these things, and
that's awesome.
Told a story on how Richard Dreyfuss and he are not on good terms, because he's a big Jaws fan. And he got a tattoo of a shark on his arm. Eddie is to reflect his fandom of Jaws, and he ran into
Richard Dreyfuss. Jaws.
Yeah, it's cool. And he showed it to Richard Dreyfuss. And as he's telling this story, everybody on the stage are almost jumping out of their chairs going, Eddie, shut up. Eddie, shut up. Lawsuit, Eddie. Eddie, shut up. Eddie, stop the story.
Libel.
Yeah, I hear you, but I got to keep telling the story. And Jamie Murray at one point stood up and goes, Eddie, this is what I talk to you about. When there's things in your head, sometimes you need to stop for a second before they come out of your mouth. This is this exact time. He goes, okay, but let me keep telling the story. And so the first part of apparently there's two parts to the story, and we never got to the lawsuit part of the story, but the first part of the story was when he was all excited, I loved you and Jaws, da, da, da. Look, I got a shark tattoo because I love it so much. He said when I showed him the tattoo, he recoiled. He actually just kind of backed away like, oh, you're creeping me out here. Then he goes, that wasn't the worst part. And that's when basically everybody on the stage said, your story is done. Get back up here.
just for those of you that may not be aware, is also an artist. He's got some very cool art, and he's designed some things. I know that
Richard
follow on Twitter actually has.
Yeah, they're all Richard Dreyfuss portraits. Right?
Yeah, somebody like really bright, colorful artwork, like really abstract and represented. I can't remember what's the word I'm looking at. It's
non-representational.
Sort of, but not. Anyway, he's got really cool, unique stuff. Somebody I follow on Twitter actually got one of his paintings, like tattooed across her calf.
Ooh.
He did a lot of the Warehouse 13 T-shirts.
Nice.
When you say calf, not cow, her leg part.
Her leg part. Okay. Cow part.
Her cow part.
Okay. Cow.
I thought she might have had a calf. And she said, "Yeah, just put that on there. That'll look great."
Hey, it hurts me a lot.
would his Facebook stuff have some of the art? Would that be a place to find it, or do you got to be more creative than that to find it?
I want to say he shared something on Twitter. He had a website, and I don't know if it's still on his about page on Twitter.
I'm sure you can Google it. Eddie McIntock art or whatever. All hail our semi-benevolent techno dictator.
Google.
I heart Richard Dreyfuss. Maybe that's the name of it.
I shark Richard Dreyfuss.
Recoil.
Speaking of which, did you, while we were there, did you see the Sharknado cosplay?
I totally did not.
Oh my god, there was a guy there on Saturday, and he had a shark hat, so the shark was actually, like, eating his head. And then he was, he had, I don't know, some kind of wire holding this tornado around him. It was, like, this gauzy cloud tornado with sharks all over it.
Nice.
Now that you mention, I do believe I did see that, so.
Okay. That's amazing.
Yeah. That was hilarious. Yeah. I thought that was funny.
Although I spent 50% of the Saturday when Jeans was down there, when she would say what location she was in, which for the average person probably wouldn't be hard to find. I'm not gifted directionally, so I would be out of McCormick Place on the street and back in, but eventually would find. So I did get a chance to see a lot of the cosplay as I wandered aimlessly everywhere.
Amazing. Well, that really is the best part about any of the cons is sort of wandering aimlessly through the crowds. It's kind of neat. We were at New York Comic Con and we decided to race through a crowd. So we had some of us, we had to get from Artist Alley to one of the other centers in Javits, and that was the first person who could get through this like crushing crowd was the winner. It was so very entertaining to try and do that because there's nothing quite like a whole huge press of people flesh to slow you right down.
There was a lot of cosplay. It was fun. Not as many as the WizardCon Comic Con, but to be fair, WizardCon Comic Con is like two floors. It's bigger. Yeah. So I think just by the sheer amount of people going, you were bound to get more people dressing up. Do you know what I mean?
Is the air conditioning any better at WizardCon?
It really was. I didn't think it was that bad this year at C2E2, but I was not wearing a flight suit this time, so.
Yeah.
He was sweating bullets.
The leather, Jane's leather jacket was really completed the outfit nicely, but was not comfortable.
Oh, man, the Jane cosplay's making me want to watch Firefly. I may have to go and do that shortly.
always a good use of time.
Always.
So it was fun. I also wanted to throw out a quick mention, running into Papa Ken, Will Damron. He does the Papa Ken media reviews. He's doing a whole series on Doctor Who right now. He reviews the shows and stuff like that. I've shared some links to some of his stuff, but I got to say hello to him.
Hey, that's exciting.
I will tag him on this. I just want to say that real quick. But yeah, I got to hang out with the Kelster all day long.
Woo.
Kelster, huh?
I'm already like queen enemy of the state, so I figure a nickname isn't going to make me that much worse.
No, I am working that. By the way, Bronwyn seems so nice. She seems like a person that's never going to be on the enemy of the state's list. However, Jeans has not only managed to be on the first level of people who wronged me, but then she went to the next level, the people who wronged me repeatedly, the uber enemies of the state. But then, you know, she has brought out that she wants to be a level above it. And in all candor, should be a level above it. I've not found the right publicly acceptable term. I've had a few ideas. That I could call that top level.
I have always admired her, you know, aiming her gung-ho nature, you know, go big or go home, right?
Exactly. Still an enemy. I think I would just prefer, like, supreme ruler of enemy of the state, but you know.
Yeah, I don't think that's
not likely.
I don't know, Jeans. You do definitely strike me as someone who would make an excellent grand vizier.
I can be evil like the fruits of the devil.
Of the devil.
So I could see grand. I could see grand in it. I'm gonna have to work on the additional. There's additional modifiers there, but.
Yeah, no cursing, because then I have to edit stuff out. So just be mindful at the moment.
I could that look at the cop. This is why she needs to be at that top level of happiness. I've been remarkably well behaved this episode.
You have been.
I don't have problem with this bad language stuff.
No,
just
problem.
Being antagonized. He's very easily antagonized.
I'm wrong.
Made for an excellent dynamic.
Because Jeans likes to antagonize, because that's clear. So she's like, oh, look, look, you can poke, and look what happens. It's like,
you're so accommodating.
Yeah. Poke the bear! Poke it! Poke the bear!
Yeah, does it take
much? I'm sorry, I do have to go shortly, but have you guys ever played sort of total non-sequitur, the ways to die, the dumb ways to die?
Yes. Yes,
no,
absolutely.
I have not.
Poke the bear. If you poke the bear right at the right time, it eventually pukes candy on you.
That sounds awesome.
Yeah, it is awesome. I will introduce you. You will get a kick out of that one.
It's a sweet app, and it's a great song, too.
Oh, my goodness. So,
it's a real earworm. Yeah. So.
Is there any...
ways to die.
Is there anything else you want to talk about Comic-Con or C2E2 related?
Gosh. So the... said the Defiant stuff was more of the same. Said Eddie just ruled the day in terms of the Defiant stuff. But no, I think I've hit most of it. I do appreciate. So I was mentioned there all 3 days. So the first day, I spent a lot of time looking at horse head masks, trying to decide if I was going to come home with one.
I
spent a lot of time
can't.
every day.
Just to put it in the bed, you know? Like,
I just
she doesn't get it either. I don't get it. I saw them, and I don't get it.
Which is why I don't have one, because I couldn't really articulate the business case for the horse head. You know what I'm saying? This is why. This is why.
You're not the godfather. Like, no.
I think I need one, but so I'm waiting on that. But
who am I to argue with random nerdy needs, you know?
It's just
sometimes you see things at a con. I have to admit, at New York Comic Con, I saw a pretty dark blue potion bottle, and I had to have it.
Yep,
no idea why, but I wore it on my belt for the rest of the trip.
Which, you know, and how is that any different than a horse head? You know, as far as it's the same thing.
I think
that's the exact same thing.
I would have bought Frankenpig if I could have, but I couldn't have carried him around my belt because he was huge.
Yeah, that would have been cool too. That was sweet. But I just wanted to thank Jeans in terms of the con itself. I had gone through Artist Alley some. But I didn't really go through it right until I went through with Jeans. So I want to say thank you for that, because
I dragged him through really slowly. We saw everybody.
You stop. You look. Because I was more, you know, keep moving like a shark so you don't drown. moving through there to the next one. And,
Artist Alley is a great place to linger.
It's very cool. There was lots and lots of good things and some hilarious signs. One of the artists Jean saw it pointed out was, it was like, he's like, I'm not here right now because I've been a bad boy and made too many, signed to do, I'm off doing commissions and these types. It was just, it was fun though, but it was great. It was cool. I'm a little bit of an autograph guy. I like to try and get a couple here and there where I can. So I did get a chance. So I'm a wrestler from way back in the day, Mick Foley, who's a really good guy and author, actually written a couple books, actually good books. He was there, and it was nice to actually get up and talk to Mick very shortly, but he's a very friendly guy. Okay. So that part was neat too. So it was all, I enjoyed it. It was all great, except
cool.
for
and,
like, food.
And Kelly bought, I think, the only Disney print that I would ever have gotten ever, because I like Disney and I'll watch the movies, but I'm not like a fangirl of it.
So here you go. I don't know how well this will translate. I need to send you a pic. But you have Rapunzel reading Hunger Games and saying, I will never, ever leave home. Leave the tower. And it once said that she highly encouraged. It's a good call.
Yeah. And
I love it.
You can't see it from where he was showing it, but the mother's in the background like, goody. You know, she's all...
Amazing. Say, Ghostbusters teaches you to never cross the streams, but every con teaches you that it's a great idea to cross the memes.
Excellent point.
Excellent.
And on that note, I think we will call it a night.
All right. Well, thank you guys for sharing your C2E2 experiences with me. Yay.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me on.
Thanks for hanging out.
Our pleasure.
Bye, guys.
See you later.
Thank you.